Okay, now we can talk about the chloroplasts, the organelles inside eukaryotic cells that provide the machinery and the scaffolding for photosynthesis to take place. So we know that chloroplasts are present in plants and some other eukaryotes. There's algae, and some protists also have chloroplasts in them. They contain the photosynthetic pigment chlorophyll that captures light energy for photosynthesis. And chlorophyll is a pigment molecule, a green pigment molecule, and chlorophyll is why plants are green. The chloroplast is surrounded by two membranes, like mitochondria and like the nucleus, which has the nuclear envelope consisting of two phospholipid bilayers. That's also true of chloroplasts. But also within chloroplasts, there's a third membrane system, which are highly folded membranes that form sacs within the inner membrane. So there's thylakoids represent a third membranous compartment of the chloroplast. And those thylakoids sacs are often stacked into grana, as we will see. So here's our schematic. Here's some chloroplasts inside a plant cell. Here's an electron micrograph shown in cross-section, and we see these stacks of thylakoids as very electron-dense, membrane-rich places where the thylakoids are stacked into these grana, or a single one is called a granum. Grana is plural. So here's our schematic that describes things. The chloroplast has an outer membrane, an inner membrane, and then here are the membrane, highly folded membrane sacs inside the inner membrane, which are stacked into grana. Here's a single granum. And the granum, the thylakoids provide large amounts of surface area. This highly folded membrane system provides large amounts of surface area whereby the molecular machinery that harvests light and captures that light energy for the purpose of photosynthesis can be embedded. So there are proteins embedded in the thylakoid membranes that are responsible for capturing light energy and starting the transduction process that will turn that into food. Also within chloroplasts, there are ribosomes. They have their own ribosomes, like mitochondria have their own ribosomes, and they have their own circular DNA molecules, multiple DNA molecules in each chloroplast. And there can be hundreds of chloroplasts in a single cell. Now this brings us to the concept of the evolution of the eukaryotic cell and the origin of mitochondria and chloroplasts. And the theory that describes their origin is one of endosymbiosis. That is, that mitochondria and chloroplasts are endosymbionts. They've become symbiotic with another type of cell, and together the symbiosis led to the formation of what we would call a eukaryotic cell. So let's cover the main features of endosymbiosis, and then I have a little movie clip for you. So it's a proposable that eukaryotic organelles evolve through a symbiotic relationship, as I've said, and that one cell engulfed a second cell and a symbiotic relationship developed. We don't know what the first cell was trying to do with the second cell. It might have been trying to eat it. It might have been trying to have sex with it. We really don't know. We can't go back that far. But the evidence for the origin of mitochondria and chloroplasts as endosymbionts inside another cell is quite strong. So mitochondria and chloroplasts were once free-living bacteria. And we will go over this evidence in just a minute, but I think I'll play you a little movie clip first.
I heard Yoda talking about midichlorians. I've been wondering, what are midichlorians?
Midichlorians are a microscopic life form that resides within all living cells.
They live inside me.
Inside your cells, yes. And we are symbionts with them.
Symbionts?
Life forms living together for mutual advantage. Without the midichlorians, life could not exist, and we would have no knowledge of the Force. They continually speak to us, telling us the will of the Force. When you learn to quiet your mind, you'll hear them speaking to you.
So the midichlorians clearly were derived from the endosymbiotic theory of the origin of mitochondria and chloroplasts. And although we don't have any evidence for a force, we do have evidence for the endosymbiotic origin of these organelles. First of all, mitochondria and chloroplasts both have two membranes. And what I'd like to do is just draw for you what would an engulfment of one bacterium by another, both having plasma membranes, would look like. So if we had a small bacterium here with a plasma membrane, and I'm not drawing the plasma membrane as a double bilayer, but you know that as a bilayer, but you know that it is a phospholipid bilayer. And another bacterium exists that is engulfing this bacterium, let's say a larger bacterium that's engulfing this. Well, as engulfment occurs, the fusion of the membrane here and here, as these are brought together to engulf the bacterium, will create a situation whereby the inner bacterium is surrounded in a vesicle by what was previously plasma membrane. So we've brought the bacterium now, the prey bacterium, if you will, into the cell, and what it surrounds that is former plasma membrane of the engulfing cell. So we have two membranes exist now here. This is a double membrane. Now, of course, normally this would be digested if this were in a situation of predator and prey, but the idea is that that these activities led to the eventual evolution of a symbiotic relationship between an organelle that evolved, containing now a double membrane system. And inside that second membrane would be remnants of the previous free-living bacteria. And that is exactly what we see, because not only do mitochondria and chloroplasts have two membranes, but they also possess their own DNA and ribosomes, as we've examined. So they have their circular DNA, which bacteria have, circular chromosomes, and they contain their own protein manufacturing machinery in ribosomes. So this is evidence clearly of a previous existence in which these mitochondria and chloroplasts, these organelles, existed as free living bacteria. They are about the size of a bacterial cell. They're about the size of a prokaryotic cell. More evidence for them being endosymbionts. And their division process resembles bacteria more than it resembles a eukaryotic type of division. So the DNA within mitochondria and chloroplasts replicates, and the mitochondria and chloroplasts divide to produce more mitochondria and chloroplasts in a fashion that resembles that of bacteria. And we'll talk about that cell division process a little later in the class. So this is not all the evidence, but these are the key evidences that strongly support the endosymbiotic theory. And we can look at this in a schematic form here. So we imagine that the prokaryotes arose when cellular life essentially arose. And we know that there were photosynthetic prokaryotes, the cyanobacteria. We have fossil evidence for them over 3.5 billion years ago. And we surmise that there were aerobic prokaryotes that learned to use the oxygen produced by photosynthetic prokaryotes and conduct oxidative metabolism using oxygen as a final electron acceptor, as we will see when we study the metabolism. So we previously talked about the evolution of the nucleus through the infoldings of plasma membranes. And the idea is that one of these proto-eukaryotes ingested an aerobic prokaryote in some manner, we don't know how. And the endosymbiosis then evolved. So we had a eukaryotic cell then capable of conducting oxidative metabolism on the basis of having these aerobic prokaryotes that have evolved to live inside this proto-eukaryotic cell. So here we have the eukaryotic cell, double membrane nucleus and mitochondria. And then in a second branch of evolution, a second ingestion of a photosynthetic prokaryote occurred at some point, and this led to the branching into plants and algae. Note the time scale here. We're looking at ancient time periods. It's very difficult to peer into this deep evolutionary past and deduce exactly what happened here. But nevertheless, the evidence for the endosymbiosis is quite strong. And you can imagine that the eukaryotic cell that ingested the proto-eukaryotic cell that ingested an aerobic prokaryote would benefit greatly from the oxidative metabolism provided by the aerobic prokaryote. And likewise, you can envision that the aerobic prokaryote perhaps derived benefits from being inside this larger cell. Now, what about this larger cell? We envision that the larger cell was actually an archaeal bacteria that was developing into a proto-eukaryote, because there are similarities in the genomes of archaea and eukaryotic organisms. Of course, the benefits to the plant cell are obvious. If you can produce your own food by ingestion of a photosynthetic prokaryote, you have a big leg up in the battle for energy resources. Now we can move on to the cytoskeleton and talk about the major components of cytoskeletal elements inside the eukaryotic cell. The cytoskeleton is a network of protein fibers, and the key word here is fibers, because the cytoskeletal proteins assemble into long fibers or cables inside the cell. And that those cables help support the shape of the cell, and they also provide for motility in some cases by being able to reshape the cell and allow it to move. The cytoskeleton keeps organelles in fixed location. The cytoskeleton kind of organizes the cell. And also, the cables of the cytoskeleton can serve as conduits upon which materials are transported. So for example, in a long nerve cell with a long axon, a material makes its way from the cell body to the nerve terminal by virtue of being transported along long cytoskeletal cables. Okay, now we'll pick up with, in our next part, the types of cytoskeletal elements that exist, and that's where we'll pick up.